No let up in front, Clark leading Hill and then Amon. A slight spot of suspension trouble slows down the Flying Scotsman, but his lead is overwhelming. A shout of victory from Colin Chapman.
In the 1960s, Colin Chapman transformed Grand Prix racing. Probably the greatest innovator since Brunel, he won 7 world championships and changed Formula One from a gentleman's sport into a $3 billion business. Before Chapman, Britain was the outsider. After Chapman, only Britain counted.
As an individual, Chapman was a complete firebrand, a complete original. He created an era. His way of thinking dominated racing for years to come. To my mind, it was tragic that he was never given a knighthood. If anybody deserved to be Sir Colin Chapman, it was he.
From 1961 to 1978, if you beat Lotus and Chapman, you'd won.
And he would do anything for his team Lotus, anything. And I don't think he really cared whether it was defrauding shareholders or defrauding anybody else. I suspect that, you know, he probably wouldn't even thought about it.
He was a genius and he was a rogue. Definitely a genius, allegedly a rogue.
The last year of Chapman's life was overshadowed by rumours surrounding his involvement in the DeLorean conspiracy, perhaps the financial scandal of the 1980s. But as the investigators closed in, his early death saw him take his secrets to the grave. When Chapman started building cars, just after the war, the British motor industry was the second biggest in the world, after the USA. But its products were too often old-fashioned, heavy and clumsy. In contrast, Chapman's cars would be modern, light and agile. In motor racing, Britain was not just an outsider, but had nothing to compete with the Germans and Italians, who had dominated Grand Prix since the 20s. Grand Prix was a matter of national pride. The Italian cars were red, the German silver, the French blue, the British, British Racing Green. But there were no winning British cars. No British car had ever won a single Grand Prix. No British driver had ever been world champion. Britain was the sporting loser.
Roche, number 36, leading British car, is in 16th place as they go through the other half of the loop at Country Court.
Chapman changed all that and, almost as an afterthought, created the only new post-war British car company, designing some of the most radical road cars ever made. Chapman had started building cars as a 19-year-old engineering student in a lock-up garage in London in 1947. The first two Lotuses were trials cars based on old Austins, and he took Hazel, his future wife, as his passenger. 4 years later, he built his first racing car, winning everything as both driver and designer. His secret weapon was getting more power from the engine everyone used by exploiting a loophole in the regulations, a typical Chapman move.
To Colin, rules were something to be challenged, to be circumvented, and he must have spent hours reading rule books and trying to find loopholes. If he was involved in framing rules, he would make sure that the rules were framed with a loophole available to him.
By 1955, Chapman was becoming so successful, he gave up his full-time job, and Lotus made its first appearance at Le Mans, with him as number one driver. The next year, he entered three Lotuses, and one of them won its class, helping to sell over 200 similar models in 1 year. Chapman was well on his way. A few weeks later, by chance, a cameraman was filming during practice for the French Grand Prix. What he was about to capture would prove to be a key moment in Chapman's career. His brakes failed, costing him the chance of a Formula One debut. He never would race in a Grand Prix.
When he drove a Van Wall, he was very nearly as quick as Hawthorn. I've driven with Stewart, Graham Hill, Stirling, Fangio even. And Colin was as good, smooth. I never had a problem riding with him as a passenger. Other people have, but I didn't.
From now on, Chapman concentrated on design, not driving. And at the next motor show, Lotus showed three cars. The Lotus 7, still made today. The Lotus Elite, arguably the best-looking car of its time. And the Lotus 12, which pointed the way towards Chapman's Formula One ambitions. The big moment arrived 3 years later, when a Lotus won a Grand Prix for the first time at Monaco, in the hands of Britain's most famous driver.
Well, in his early days with his racing cars, of course, frankly, they were beautiful to drive. Not easy, but delicate, but very, very quick, very light, and I can tell you, very delicate as far as the strength was concerned. And in fact, I had quite a few wheels come off. The most important one, in a way, I suppose, was when I was racing at Spa, and my front wheel came off at about 140 miles an hour. And obviously I knew there was something wrong because I could see it go. And I managed to spin out and go in the bank backwards. I broke my back and my legs on that occasion.
His structures professor, when he was studying engineering, had told him that, you know, any damn fool can build a bridge and it won't fall down. But it takes a man of much greater skill to build a bridge that just won't fall down. In other words, that working at the margin was very, very typical of Collins' operations in general, and very particular in the sense that he worked on very few principles about engineering. These were elegance, refinement, simplicity. He was a stylist, I guess, in some ways, rather than a real engineer.
I remember at the American Grand Prix, which I won in, I think, 59 or something, and they made me a cake with a Lotus on top. And the first cut I made, of course, was one of the wheels. And I said, would you give it to Colin Chapman? And he didn't interest me at all.
Colin was uninterested in both spectators and certainly deeply uninterested in safety. Never heard him utter a word about whether his monocoques were, what would happen if your driver's legs got chopped off in it. Never a word.
When you're dealing with people's lives, and you are, when wheels fall off at over 100 miles an hour, or even less, I think it's something one has to think about, and I don't think it worried him too much at the beginning.
Once, he even tried to convince officials that paper was fireproof.
And he'd taken a road map from the wall of the garage where he was working, and had put it between the engine and the driving compartment, cut holes for the steering column and cables and wires, and had painted it with aluminium paint. And the officials were absolutely scandalised and said, this is not a fireproof bulkhead. And Colin said, yes, it is. And there was quite a row going on, which they didn't seem to be able to resolve. And I was asked if I would be prepared to protest that he was going to be allowed to compete, not complying with the rules. And I said, no, you do your own dirty work.
Chapman's reputation for putting lightness before safety haunted him a decade later. He was charged with manslaughter following the death of Joachim Rindt.
When the car swung, it hit a post for an overhead loudspeaker and swung round, and it tore the front of the car off, front wheels, bulkhead, and of course his feet were in the pedals. It pulled him through the seat belts and they cut his throat, and he died in the wreckage on the spot. The Italians impounded the wreckage, and Colin was charged with manslaughter. And the charge was dismissed, and Colin was very cross. He said, I didn't want to get off because I had retained the best lawyer. I wanted it proved that I don't make unsafe racing cars.
Chapman was finally cleared of Rindt's death, but the accusations against his cars of being fragile and unsafe never went away. 1963, Chapman achieved his real goal when he won his first world championship with the youngest ever champion, the legendary Jim Clark. Chapman rarely acknowledged the contribution of others. Clark was the exception.
Jimmy was, in my opinion, probably the greatest racing driver there's ever been. He's had a very rare combination of a fantastically high intellect, a fantastically high ability, with a tremendous concentration. And I don't think there are any other drivers that, in my experience of Grand Prix racing over the last 10 years, have ever equaled or ever likely to equal the sort of total race driver concept that Jimmy was.
Jimmy could tell Colin what the car needed, Colin could give it to Jimmy, and they worked together in the most incredible way. And I've never saw Colin lose his temper with Jimmy either. They had a most wonderful working relationship.
Clark would drive for no one but Chapman, and Chapman inspired a similar loyalty in all those who worked for him.
He was able to drag out of them a loyalty which was unbelievable, almost robotic, you know? And in a different time, different place, Chapman could have easily been a Hitler. He had that ability, and it was down to charisma.
But he was a terrific motivator. He got more out of you than you thought you could ever do.
You could hate him 1 minute, and the next minute you'd be going, yeah, right, I'll do that, yeah, you know. And he was like that with most people, really. He could charm the birds off the trees. If that's what it took, he'd do it. He'd cry, he'd do anything. Oh, I need money, you know.
He could manipulate me. And I'd go into his office breathing fire and slaughter and saying, there's no way we're going to do it. And I'd come out 5 minutes later saying, we're going to do this. He'd talk me round.
When I was in Ibiza with him, we were on the beach and I had one of those funny wet bike things. Anyway, somebody tipped it over and the engine conked up. Colin took the engine cover off and he's looking at it. And within minutes, he had people round him, and within more minutes, he was directing people with wrenches to take the engine out. I didn't even know who these people were. I'm going to swear that most of the people who were helping didn't even know who he was. He just had that ability to become a leader just by charisma.
Colin Chapman, designer and builder of the Lotus 25, has always been a pioneer. He built his first car while he was still an engineering student. And since then, Colin has come a long way. And his many contributions to motor racing include major developments in suspension and monocoque construction. Colin's personal dynamism has inspired an outstanding group of draftsmen, engineers, and mechanics, and has united them into a formidable team, Team Lotus, the team supporting the world champion.
Clark's championship-winning car was a perfect example of Chapman's philosophy. Traditionally, cars had a separate chassis and body. Chapman's monocoque united them in a single unit.
Chapman decided that he would leave out the chassis and he would make a motor car out of a series of fuel tanks built round the driver, in this case Jimmy Clark, perfectly to fit Jimmy Clark. He even said that the oil pipes ran between Jimmy's cheeks in the base of the car. And on this he attached a racing engine and gearbox without any extraneous material at all.
Well, Dick, now we get to the interesting bit. We bolt the engine onto the car, as you can see.
Yes.
And now we bolt the rest of the suspension on the back of the engine, because the engine itself is forming part of the structure of the car.
Right.
And, of course, it holds it all together.
He was most emphatic that each part had got to do three jobs. Elegant simplicity was the keynote he always hammered down my throat. Got to be elegant and it's got to be simple.
Alfa Oscar now likes to take off. Can you clear the track, please?
Roger, will do.
A As a world champion, Chapman started to adopt a lifestyle to match.
Well, in the 60s, a lot of people had mistresses or girlfriends. I did. And it was rumoured that Colin had one or perhaps two, but nothing you could really pin down.
By 1964, Colin was really wearing his mistress on his sleeve, very open secret. I'm inclined to think that he just regarded it as another status symbol, another toy, if you like, in the same way that he had to have the latest aeroplane or any other gadget.
Colin had three lives. He had his family life, which was totally divorced from his other two lives. He had his private life, okay, which did not necessarily include his family. Then he had his business life. And he was able to run those three in parallel without them crisscrossing too many times and organise himself in such a way that he never really come up with a conflict. And occasionally, as I understand it, and this is hearsay, but kind of Hazel left him a couple of times, you know, when things got a bit tough, or, you know, she'd run away for a weekend and to friends. But in general terms, he was able to kind of keep all the balls in the air and everybody kind of lived happy, kind of.
The obsession with each element doing more than one job even extended to his private life. Once in the 60s, a mistress doubled as a secretary, which brought its own problems in the office.
Why don't you just meet a girl occasionally? You know, to go to dinner, and if you have fun, you have fun. Why do you need to bring all the baggage on board, you know, where, you know, you're walking in the morning, they're out at the office, and, you know, all that? Well, and, right, what a good idea. Why don't we do that? Okay, so what are we going to do with this one? Let's get rid of her. No. You get rid of her. Okay, that's fine. So we have the conversation, and that young lady goes. Anyway, there's some people I knew down in London, an escort agent, and they sent a really pretty girl up. And he was supposed to have dinner with her. And he couldn't, he didn't have the guts, he lacked the confidence to be able to sit down with somebody on his own. And he wanted me to go to dinner as well. And I said, no, I'm not going to diss that, you know. So in the end, that all kind of went to wash out. And then we had the job of getting the old one back again.
Chapman's closest relationship in his business life came to a tragic end in 1968.
I did get very, very close to Jim Clark. He was, I would say, my best friend I've ever had. We got on terribly well together. I understood exactly what he wanted and so on, and I think he understood exactly what I meant when we conversed on the subject. And this is the tragedy of motor racing, is when you do get close to a driver and there is an accident, of course it hurts you so much more.
We went to the hospital and they kept us hanging around for a long time and nobody saying anything, and then we were ushered into a room. And to my amazement, I was offered a glass of, I think, brandy, something fairly stiffening, which, I mean, immediately confirmed my worst fears. And then they said, yes, Jimmy Clark is dead.
Driving a Lotus, he crashed into the trees at 140 miles an hour in a minor race he had no need to enter.
Everybody who knew Colin will tell you that he was absolutely desolated by the death of Jim Clark.
I've never seen anyone so low for a guy who was, you know, always on top of everything. He was shattered. Mm-hmm.
It almost became as if Colin was a widower. He'd lost his partner and he grieved deeply.
He'd disappeared off the face of the earth for 3 weeks. Nobody knew in the factory or anywhere else where he was. He was lost.
Right now at Argos, there are hundreds and hundreds of new products at the most amazing prices. Personal stereos, cameras, jewellery, dining suites, Batman toys, microsystem shavers, CD-ROMs, watches, mobile phones, irons, hairdryers, sofas, baby bouncers, Action Man toys, Barbie skating gear and a whole lot more. To find out why they're going so fast, pick up the new Argos catalogue now. Argos takes care of it.
Scotland. Just one number, just one question. For your autumn gold brochure, call 0345 511 511.
Welcome to Britain's biggest ever computer sale at PC World now. Massive savings throughout the store. PC World. Don't miss out.
Little Scourer from Spontex. It's the most hard-working little scourer you can get. It cuts straight through grease and tough dirt and even eats up dent on food. It's easy to rinse clean and it doesn't rust. Tough Scourer from Spontex. It's a little pet in the kitchen.
Everyday brushing with Sensodyne F now helps fight gum disease and tooth decay, as well as fighting the pain of sensitivity. Sensodyne F.
Look. The logo's rotating. That was very cool.
I like that.
Yeah.
You guys do this all day?
No, not all day.
Just most of the day.
Wow, that is very cool. What is that?
The logo's on fire.
Why is the logo on fire?
It's a flaming logo.
Yeah.
We're checking out different business websites.
It's trying to determine our website strategy.
Website strategy, huh?
Yeah.
You ever think about using this to sell something?
IBM helps business websites do business.
Yeah, the worst thing about New York is the cab drivers. I mean, they never know where they're going.
Yeah, but what about all those great clothes shops?
You've got great shops too.
Maybe. But the absolute best thing about New York is the food. You can walk straight into a deli any time, and they'll make you up a massive sandwich the size of a skyscraper. Gorgeous filling. You just don't get any sandwiches over here.
You've obviously been away too long.
New Hellman's Deli Sandwich Mayonnaise. Four ways to make any sandwich delicious.
Argos has hundreds of new products like personal stereos, cameras, jewellery, dining suites, microsystem shavers, hair dryers, watches, toys, a whole lot more. To find out why they're going so fast, pick up the new Argos catalogue now.
Money, or the lack of it, was a constant problem for Chapman. Ferrari, and later Renault, virtually had the backing of their respective governments. Chapman always had to fight for private finance, and resented having it taken off him for the public purse.
Chapman had a deep dislike of paying income tax if he could possibly avoid it, and this was extended to all aspects of Team Lotus. So fairly early on in the 1960s, when he was running some very expensive professional drivers, Jimmy Clark and Graham Hill, he and Fred Bushell together established an operation called GPD, Grand Prix Drivers, which was an offshore company. I think it had roots in Panama and was operated out of Geneva. And the purpose of this was to avoid any funds being channeled back into the United Kingdom and becoming subject to British income tax.
And unfortunately, I had said, well, I thought this is a perfectly good example of tax evasion. And he nearly got up and hit me. And he gave me a great big lecture how about tax evasion is a crime, tax avoidance is a science, and that he was all involved with the science and didn't want to know about the crime.
The racing team's finance was intended to come from his car company's profits. But it too had recurring financial crises. To raise money, Chapman tried to cash in on his name by selling shares in Lotus.
Colin Chapman never, ever should have gone public with his company. That was a huge mistake. I think he acknowledged that, and he certainly would have bought it back if he possibly could. He had no patience whatsoever for the interests of shareholders. If he continued simply running a private company, which is what he should have done, and of course what he wanted to do, things would have been different.
He had great difficulty in being able to compartmentalise a public company, its money, private company, its money. In fact, there were occasions when his private companies bailed out the public company. He never was able to differentiate between them, and it didn't matter to him anyway. The shareholders of Lotus were purely people who'd been given the opportunity of participate in Colin Chapman's success?
There was an element of the hooligan in Colin, and we had quite a few hooligan nights out. I won't tell you how we wrecked the paddle steamer on the River Thames, that's another story. But we, part of the public flotation was we rented a bus and went down London in it and had a marvellous time. And at one point, the police were loading the ladies of the night into a Black Mariah, and by the time the police had got the ladies of the night in, the Black Mariah had no tail lights and no headlights, and Colin had got the lot.
For 10 years, Chapman had struggled to put British Racing Green at the front. But overnight, he painted Lotus red. In fact, the exact colours of a gold leaf cigarette packet. It caused outrage. This was an entirely new type of sponsor. His flying fag packet would open the financial floodgates, changing motorsport forever. Bizarrely, Chapman hated cigarettes. Smoking at Lotus was forbidden.
We would really come under fire. There's no need to be lighting up cigarettes. You don't need smoking. I don't like the smell of smoke. It's not a good thing to do. So you very quickly learned that it wasn't worth the aggravation, because his willpower was such, he was a very strong willed person, and that was how, I suppose, we eventually all did as we were told, was that he almost nagged you to death over it, that no, you weren't to smoke.
By 1970, Chapman had romped home to his fourth world championship. But the establishment only rewarded him with second prize in the honours list.
The next thing I heard was that he was going to get the CBE. They actually told me through the back door before they told him. And when I inquired further as to why it was only the CBE, they said, unfortunately, he hit a policeman in a country that has a queen, which was, he actually hit a policeman at the Dutch Grand Prix one year and was locked up for 2 days because he thumped him really hard, because they wouldn't let him in the pits. And had that been, shall we say, a policeman in Yugoslavia, that would have been all right. But if you insult the crown by hitting one of the policemen, then you don't get the knighthood.
1978 was the most glorious year of Chapman's racing career, dominating Formula One as no team had ever done before, winning 8 Grand Prix, often coming home first and second, the competition lucky to be on the same lap. The season ended with Lotus just one win short of Ferrari's all-time total. But amid glory, death struck again. In Italy, Ronnie Peterson, the number two driver, crashed.
I have very, very clear memories of Ronnie Peterson saying to me at the end of his contract year, he said, well, I just don't intend to be another dead hero for Colin Chapman.
When Peterson died in last year's model, Chapman refused responsibility, blaming the racing team for not finishing a new and safer car in time.
Colin always felt Peterson wouldn't have been killed if he'd been driving a Type 79 with a carbon fibre tub. He was driving a Type 78 with an aluminium honeycomb, and it crumpled and crushed his feet, and he eventually died with a poisoning or something. And that was Colin turned his face against the racing team then. He became much more remote. Instead of being in the workshop with them, laughing and joking, he didn't go into the workshop anymore.
Chapman now seemed to lose his passion for racing. It would be 4 years before Lotus won another race. With his sponsors threatening to quit, Lotus sales were crashing in the States due to new safety regulations. He desperately needed a new source of cash. One day in 1978, racing journalist Peter Windsor found himself alone in Chapman's office.
I sat down and there was a notepad in the middle of the desk, and I kid you not, in the middle of the notepad there was just one word, and it was DeLorean with a line under it, and it was Chapman's handwriting.
The DeLorean sports car presents crisp aerodynamic Italian styling, featuring fully counterbalanced gull wing doors, forward luggage compartment, carpet.
John DeLorean, previously number two at General Motors, was a marketing genius. With this slick video, he was able to sell a dream. No one would have known but the cars it featured were just two cobbled-together prototypes. Within 9 days, the British government gave him £35 million to build a factory in strife-torn Belfast. It opened in early 1981 with much fanfare and closed a year later amid controversy. Falling sales, bad reviews and accusations of DeLorean's extravagance encouraged the government to refuse more funds. Within the year, £80 million of public money had been lost. The scandal arose when the receiver went through the books and alleged that design work on the car carried out by Lotus had been paid for twice. The second payment, of over $17 million, went to a mysterious Swiss company, GPD, in a contract signed by John DeLorean, Lotus finance director Fred Bushell, and Colin Chapman. It had been 4 years earlier when Chapman first heard news of the DeLorean grant. He was furious.
Lotus applied to the government for a loan or a grant of about £400,000 to assist with further Ford development. And the company received what you can only call the lame duck letter. Within days, Colin had read, and we'd all read, that John DeLorean was going to receive £35 million for what was a job-creating scheme in Northern Ireland to build sports cars on a greenfield site. Create jobs, one up to the government. Colin saw this as a personal snub. He saw this as a subsidised effort to destroy our market because we were very strong in North America where the DeLorean was going to be sold. And the cars would meet head-on. And he was naturally very, very angry. And he called a very short, sharp meeting and he said, we're going to have some of that.
Chapman's chance came when DeLorean told the British government he could turn his early prototype into a production model in a quarter of the usual time.
DeLorean desperately needed somebody to actually make a car that would actually be roadworthy and pass the very stringent American tests. And he went to Porsche, first of all, and they said, well, we'll do it, but it'll take us 7 years. We take 7 years to make a new car, and it'll cost you £40 million. And he had 18 months. He'd promised to do it in 18 months. And so he went to BMW, and they said, well, we can do it in 4 years, but it'll cost you about £50 million. We don't really want to do it anyway. And he went around everywhere, and the one person he knew could do it for him, and he had immense admiration for, was Colin Chapman.
DeLorean was desperate to sign Chapman. He first tried to buy Lotus when Chapman complained that the DeLorean would put Lotus out of business in North America. But the negotiations were hampered by Chapman's insistence on secrecy. They went on for 4 precious months of DeLorean's tight schedule, culminating in a marathon meeting in Geneva.
What we do know is that DeLorean went there almost alone. He didn't take any of his financial people from New York at all, who didn't know where he was, didn't know what he was doing, and he never briefed them on what had happened there. We do know that in his pocket he had a check for $12.5 million. Burning a hole in his pocket all that time. We also do know that Chapman and Bushell went on their own. A solicitor did come over from Northern Ireland, but sat outside, did nothing, and wasn't party to any of those talks. So these two men, Chapman and DeLorean, both of them hyperactive people, both had an attention span of 5 seconds. Neither of them could sit still in a room at all, ever, in their whole lives, for 4 days. And they didn't even like each other. Sat in this hotel room, negotiating something.
At some point during those 4 days, Chapman finally refused to sell Lotus. But he agreed to redesign the DeLorean if the profits on the job were paid up front to a Swiss company, GPD. The check in DeLorean's pocket for $12.5 million was money from his American investors. But he raised the amount to $17.65 million to get Chapman. But even with this deal on the table, at the last minute, Chapman still wavered, openly contemptuous of DeLorean's prototype.
He couldn't see how this car could work, and he kept saying, nothing on your car works. You're trying to build this car with these gullwing doors just because it's a gimmick. But you can't do that because if you gullwing doors, you have to hinge in the middle of the roof and they have to come down an awful long way down to the bottom and they won't fit. And what if the car rolls over, he said. If it rolls over and sits on its roof, how do you get out of this car? the American authorities will just never pass it. They won't allow it. This car is a nonsense, and I don't want to build it. And DeLorean kept compromising and kept coming back and kept coming back. And Chapman was for walking out of the deal. He actually genuinely didn't want DeLorean's money at that point. It's a very interesting point. And it was Fred Bushell who kept pulling him back and saying, we need the money. We need this work. Please, come back in and talk to the guy. At least talk to the guy. Keep talking. And sometime during that period, we can only speculate here. I don't think we'll ever fully know the answer. But sometime during that period, John DeLorean must have said, look, we will pay this money. I've raised now $17.65 million. For research and development. Now, I'm going to give you, he must have said half, because we now know they've effectively split that money.
And Colin Chapman.
DeLorean claims that Chapman got all the money, then spent half of it on DeLorean shares.
What happened, Chapman was convinced that our company was going to put his out of business. So he refused to take the contract unless he had an opportunity to buy a substantial interest in DeLorean Motor Company.
That substantial interest was $60 million worth of DeLorean shares, which he says Chapman got for the bargain price of $8.5 million.
And DeLorean went back to America knowing that now he had the world's greatest car engineer who was going to build his car for him, but it wasn't anymore going to be a DeLorean car. It was now a Lotus car, because the only way Chapman can do it in those 18 months was basically to build the car that he was already building, the Turbo Esprit, is going to be a new model. So basically, this DeLorean car became a version, slightly altered version, of the Turbo Esprit.
Well, there's no question you've got a beautiful car there. It reminds me a lot of a Lotus, the Lotus Esprit, and I guess that's not surprising since it was designed by...
No, I don't think it looks like a Lotus at all.
What does it remind you of?
That it's unique. Doesn't remind me of anything that's ever been done before.
Corvette or Porsche?
No, doesn't look like any of those.
Not even a bit like a Lotus?
No, I don't see where the similarity is to Lotus. Lotus is a different automobile.
The chassis, my Lotus,
land. Well, as you see, the chassis has a very Lotus-like design, but then this is what we understand and which we believe works well.
Yeah.
And it's very nice to see John DeLorean productionizing it and producing it in such large volumes.
Yeah.
But less than 9,000 DeLoreans were made before the factory closed. The missing million would haunt Chapman for the rest of his life.
Sale prices in the Comet Price Index in Saturday's papers. Get it right. Come to Comet.
This old house once knew its children. This old house once knew its wife. This old house was home and comfort as they fought the storms of life. This old house once rang with laughter. This old house heard many shouts. Now he trembles in the darkness when the lightning walks about.
And you're gonna need this house no longer. Ain't they gonna need this house no more.
Ain't got time to fix the shingles. Ain't got time to fix the floor.
Aquatonic by Fabergé.
This is Mornington, and these are the Johnsons, back from the holidays.
Your stomach for 1 minute, nothing to eat.
These people are starving. Kellogg's Corn Flakes.
They're still fresh.
All that crisp, golden Kellogg's taste sealed right in.
No milk.
You'll never get to the honey,
face the music and dance.
Because life's a funny old game, and your career may not last as long as you think, Ally Dunbar's financial plans adapt to help you face the unexpected.
Let's face the music and dance.
Are you all right? You look like death.
You should have seen the other bloke.
Ally Dunbar, for the life you don't yet know.
Unlike some wood stains, Cuprinol's five-year wood stain lasts five whole years. Guaranteed. Cuprinol. No one does wood more good.
The Clio Paris and the Clio Provence. Perfect for town and country pursuits.
Papa?
Come.
The Clio Collection from 6995 on the road.
The DeLorean factory closed when the government pulled the plug in February 1982. The receiver's questions about the upfront payment of $17 million to GPD were stalled by Chapman, who managed to put the meeting off for 6 months until October of that year.
Chapman's stance throughout the meeting was to deny any knowledge of the 17.65. He said it's a number he'd heard quoted. He denied that his company had received any of that particular money.
Chapman felt it was none of the receiver's business. He was notoriously cavalier about where money came from and went to. The millions from racing sponsors were rarely accountable. He felt what he did with the profits from the DeLorean job was his affair.
We made a contract with Colin Chapman and with GPD, which is a company he owned in Switzerland, to do the engineering work. The contract called for the upfront payment of the profits on the contract to go to GPD. We took that contract to the government, to the Secretary of for Northern Ireland, to the NIDA, and to the Bank of England, and had it approved prior to entering into it. Once we did, before we could make the payments, we had to go to the Bank of England and again to the same people who issued the checks to make the payments. They agreed to it, and they knew exactly what was happening.
DeLorean and Chapman kept pointing out the GPD contract was legal. But Chapman claimed to the receiver that the $17 million payment to GPD was an introductory fee for bringing him and DeLorean together.
He came across relaxed, very confident, as I say, very healthy, with a very good suntan. And he seemed to be convinced of what he was telling us. He seemed to take the view that if he answered our questions and if we were sensible chaps, we'd understand his explanation. He didn't seem to be anything other than perfectly normal to him that $17.5 million could be paid as an introductory fee.
But Chapman's story was contradicted by a letter adding a condition to the GPD contract, a copy of which journalists investigating the DeLorean affair had been handed anonymously. They eventually put it before Fred Bushell, Chapman's finance director.
And finally, we produced a letter which had been signed by Colin Chapman and by Fred Bushell in that hotel in 1978 in Geneva, which actually committed the group Lotus, that's the public company, guaranteeing GPD's work. It actually specifically named GPD. Group Lotus was guaranteeing GPD. Now, this letter was dynamite. And we put that letter on the table, and Fred Bushell said, I've never seen that letter before. And I said, is that your signature? And he said, well, it might be. I said, well, it's either your signature or the thing is a forgery. But if it's not a forgery, this letter actually does show that not only did you know about GPD, but you actually guaranteed GPD's work as a public company. And the shareholders never knew that. You were guaranteeing an enormous contract, which would bust Group Lotus, and very nearly did. At that stage, he asked for a pause, And I remember we went out, and the tension in the room was crackling.
This letter proved that the shareholders of Lotus were being defrauded. Chapman and Bushell had failed to declare to the Lotus shareholders the upfront profit paid to GPD, which eventually showed up in Chapman and Bushell's Swiss accounts. November 1978 marked a turning point for Chapman. At the peak of his racing career, having won his seventh world championship, he was made a Freeman of Norwich, only 5 days after signing the DeLorean contract, knowing he had crossed the line between bending the rules and serious fraud. Behind his public confidence, life was getting complicated.
He was by that time taking amphetamines and almost certainly sleeping tablets. He and I were once forced to share a hotel room in America, and he set an alarm for 4 o'clock in the morning, took two little yellow tablets and said, well, they'll wake me up at six, all bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. And I was finding that his memory was seeming to go, and that if I had a meeting with him and there was a major decision to be taken, I was having to cover them myself with a memo to him, a memo to his secretary, and a third one to his house to say, this is to confirm what we agreed at 11 o'clock this morning.
According to his assistant, Chapman's private life was also getting confused with his family life.
You're coming to dinner at the house tonight. I said, oh, I am? Yeah. Hazel would like a word with you. Okay. I said, can you give me a clue? Yeah, well, he said, what happened was, the other night, I was out with and I was at a traffic signal, and Hazel drew up in her Elite beside me. So I said, so she saw yeah. I said, what did you do? He said, I just put my foot down, went through the light. So I said, okay, fine. So I said, so what did you say afterwards? He said, well, here, this is where I need your help. What I said was that you'd taken out, you'd gone down to La Laconda, the local Italian restaurant at Blowfield, and you'd got drunk, made a bit of a fuss, had called me up. I'd gone out there in my Merc to pick you both up, and I was coming back. You were laid out on the back seat, and that's how Hazel didn't see you, but you were there. Is that okay? I said, well, I could probably, you know, get on with that, yeah. So we go to dinner that night, and there's Hazel one end, kind of the other end, and we start this meal, and it's real frosty. Real frosty. So halfway through the meal, Hazel puts down a cutlery. She said, I'm sorry, I just have to get this off my chest right now, Tim. She said, I am absolutely disgusted with you. I said, how's that, Hazel? You are a director of a public company of which my husband is the chairman. How dare you go out locally with girls and get drunk and make an exhibition of yourself in a public restaurant and have my husband have to come and pick you up. I thought, okay, I can take this. I looked at Colin, he looks down at his head, he says, this has got to stop, Tim. Anyway, I go out to the porch saying goodnight, Hazel's got it off her chest. The old man turns around and he says, you know, Tim, Hazel's got a point, you know, you've got to start behaving yourself, you know, you've got to live up to the position I've put you in. And I'm walking out to my car thinking, hold it, this guy now actually believes what he told her. And I think, you know, if you ask other people who were around in those last couple of years, 3 years, he really began to get scary from that point of view. Really scary, but he would believe those things.
Into this world of make-believe came a fairy tale sponsor, awash with money. The Albert Hall, February 1980. $1 million worth of smoke, champagne and dancing girls launched Chapman's latest Lotus. Yet no one had ever heard of Essex, the name emblazoned on the car. Essex, a Monaco-based oil dealing company, was owned by entrepreneur David Team.
Team was the major, the sole successor to John Player. His company was called Essex. A very odd man, Team, anyway, to have anything to do with Formula One. From an art background,
He was a true 1960s character, complete with ponytail and everything else, and a saturnine and a strange man who operated basically out of telephones and computers inside a Monaco apartment dealing in spot oil.
The world of oil dealing was extremely volatile. In 1 year, David Team made $70 million. Chapman was mesmerized by the orgy of cash.
We were looking at various avenues to see what we could do to, as we say, illuminate our profile within the petroleum industry. And the two obvious ways to get the people to support our football and motor racing. But we have, the petroleum industry really has nothing to do with football. So we decided to do all motor racing.
And David Team lived in Monte Carlo and gave all the signs of being incredibly wealthy with his personal jet. And that had an impact on Colin. Previously, he wasn't bothered about staying, going to a good restaurant or staying at a good hotel. He would make sure Hazel had a nice hotel to stay at, but it didn't really bother him. And if you were travelling with him, a kitty cat in the cockpit of the aeroplane was all he wanted. But then he understood what the rosettes and stars meant in the guides, and he spent less time with the cars, less time with the mechanics, and more time away from the circuit.
Despite Team's millions, Lotus hadn't won a single race since the DeLorean deal was signed. Team was arrested at an airport in Switzerland in April 1981. The charges were dropped and he was completely cleared, but his Essex empire had collapsed. The fairy tale was over. John Player returned as sponsor, but Chapman's luck did not. This last great innovation never reached the starting grid.
It's meeting a lot of resistance from the traditionalists in racing who see it as a threat to the traditional way of building a racing car. There's two cars, really. There's the car that the driver sits in, this bit in the middle, which is softly sprung, and then there's the bodywork, which carries all the aerodynamic load, which holds the car on the ground, which has got another set of springs, and as you can see, if you move, it goes down separately from the rest of the car.
A brilliant idea, but a desperate throw at the edge of the roof. It was soon banned for good. Chapman was shattered. Losing races, Lotus facing bankruptcy, having lost its US distribution, and the DeLorean affair about to explode. Disaster threatened from all sides.
The discussions I had with Colin late September 1982, he brought up subjects concerning his death to me, which had never ever come up in conversation previously and wasn't a subject which he would normally talk to me about. In fact, it was a little bit of a taboo subject. He was very, very cold about other people dying and had never ever shown any requirement to discuss anything in those lines, even if it was just preparation.
Chapman had raised Britain to the top of Grand Prix racing. His energy, charisma, and innovative genius affected all who came into contact with him. But the constant pressure of finding finance had driven him to the GPD contract, which now threatened everything he had built up over 30 years. By the end of 1982, imprisonment, ruin, and disgrace threatened to overwhelm him. A week before Christmas, he flew back from Paris, landing in darkness. He would not see the dawn. At 4 a.m., he died of a massive heart attack in his wife's arms. It was December the 16th, 1982, and Chapman was 54. Ten years after Chapman's death, His loyal accountant, Fred Bushell, pleaded guilty to fraud in relation to the DeLorean affair and was sentenced to 3 years in jail. At his trial, the judge said, on the evidence before him, if Chapman had been in the dock, he would have got 10 years.